at the Blue Cafe, at the Blue Cafe, at the Blue Cafe, at the Blue Cafe.
Hello, welcome to the Blue Cafe, the show that features interviews with newsmakers and people of entertainment. And now your host of the Blue Cafe, Frank Allen.
Well, thank you, and welcome once again to another episode of the Blue Cafe. Thank you so much for being along with us. You know, it's impossible for me to do this show without you, so I thank you so much for being part of us. Talk about teen idols. You know, they were big in the 1950s and 60s, and we had so many of them. I'm not going to even try to name them all. But I can tell you, a lot of them started when they were real young. I mean, just practically kids coming up. Some stayed for a while, but there were others who started and never looked back. And my guest today is one of them. He started at a real young age. He's noted for his singing voice, but he became an actor, an author, and did so many things. He had big hits like Valari, Wild One, We Got Love, Kissin' Time, Swingin' School, Wildwood Days, Forget Him, and so many others. He played opposite of Ann Margaret in the classic hit in 1963 called Bye Bye Birdie. Now, if you haven't guessed by now, let me take time to welcome him. Ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure to introduce to you on the Blue Cafe, Mr. Bobby Rydell. Bobby, thank you so much for being here and welcome to the Blue Cafe.
Well, thank you ever so much, Frank. It's my pleasure.
Here you are, this young kid from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Growing up there, what was it like growing up there for you?
It was the best, Frank. You know, I was originally born on 2423 South 11th Street in South Philadelphia. And South Philadelphia, maybe you'll talk about this later on in the show, but South Philadelphia produced one hell of a lot of talent. You know, we had, you know, great jazz people. We had great singers, actors. You know, it was just a marvelous area, you know, to grow up in. And there's an old saying, I don't know if the saying goes in New York as well, but, you know, you can take the boy out of South Philadelphia, but you can't take the South Philadelphia out of the boy. And that is so true. My roots are still South Philly.
You're still there now?
Oh, no, not in South Philadelphia anymore. In an area called Bluebell, Pennsylvania, which is only about, oh, from my old neighborhood, maybe about a half an hour or so.
Did you grow up with brothers and sisters as you went along in your life?
No, I was the only child.
The only child?
Yeah, the only child, yeah.
Okay, let's get into some of what you did in your career, because you have a long career. Now, I've said this many times before. People in your era, grew up in your era, became entertainers. Some made it. Some, you know, tapered off or, you know, just left it behind. But you started as a young kid, and you're still here. And you're still here, and longevity is not an easy thing to do in this business.
No, absolutely not. It's gone on to, what now, about 61 years since 1959 when I had my first hit record, a song called Kissin' Time, Summer of 59. Yeah, it's been quite a trip.
You didn't start as a singer, did you? You started doing something else.
Yeah, matter of fact, my dad, he loved big bands. And at a very early age, I was 5 years old, he wanted to introduce me to big band music. So I'm 5 years old, he takes me to a place in Philadelphia called the Earl Theater. And the band was the Benny Goodman Band. Now, I'm 5 years old, I don't know who the heck Benny Goodman is, but my dad wanted to introduce me to that music. So I went in, and there's four trumpets, and there's four trombones, and five saxophones, full rhythm section, piano, bass, drums, rhythm, guitar. And the music was absolutely wonderful. But there was one guy in the band, and I said, I don't know that guy's name, but I want to be him. And he was the drummer for Benny Goodman, and his name was Gene Krupa, who, of course, was one of the great drummers of our day, you know. And I started playing drums at 5 years old. To answer your question,
did you know at that particular point you can actually sing other than playing the drums?
Well, I remember when my dad was in the service, he was overseas, and, you know, of course, my mom and dad used to write back and forth to one another. And I was, I think, 3 years old at the time, and my mom kept writing my father, "The baby's always singing, the baby's always singing." And to this day, I still have the letter in my possession that my father wrote back. Who knows? knows, Jenny? Maybe one day we'll have a star in the family.
I saw a photo of you. I would imagine you were on the Red Skelton show or something. You had that hat on that he wore, doing the Clem Cadiddle Hopper. How did that come about? How did the impressions came about?
I think it was my very first show for Mr. Skelton, and I was sitting in the audience. And the producer came over. His name was Cecil Barker. And he says, I think I was 18, 19 years old at the time. Mm-hmm. And he says, I understand you do one of Red's characters. And I said, yes, I do Clem Cadiddle Hopper. Mm-hmm. He says, can I hear it? And I started, you know, like Clem. So anyway, Mr. Skelton is over my left, rehearsing with the David Rose Orchestra, and he overhears me, and he starts coming back at me. From that thing, I imitated one of Red's characters on the show. He played Clem Cadiddle Hopper. I played his cousin Zeke Cadiddle Hopper, and it was precious. And from what I understand, I was one of the only guest stars who ever imitated one of Red's characters, you know, on the TV show.
You just told me your father was an inspiration to you on getting you into the entertainment area.
Sure.
Was your dad also an entertainer?
No, not at all. But at a very early age, my father used to take me around to nightclubs when I was 7, 8 years old. And he would ask the club owner, is it okay if my son got up and to sing, you know, a couple songs and do some impersonations? And I would get up and I would sing a song and I'd do my impersonations and people would applaud. And I thought at that age, you know, I said, wow, all I have to do is do this and they do that. What a wonderful feeling. So basically the only reason I'm in the business today is because of my dad, because if I had any talent within me whatsoever, my dad was the first one to see it. And basically, that was like kind of my vaudeville, which kind of got me ready for things that were going to happen later on in my life as far as my career was concerned.
Most parents would do the opposite of what your dad did. They would like try to talk you out of it and do something else.
Oh, well, my mother used to say to my father, and my father's nickname was Ott, O-T-T, Ott. And my mother used to say, Ott, what are you doing with this kid? And my father said, Jenny, the kid's got talent. And my mother said, well, what the hell else are you going to say? You're the father. Yeah, so my mother, I guess, was never really for it. But when things started happening for me, she was 100% behind me as well.
Hey, listen, let's talk about some of your music, too. Your music, as you were getting in, when you finally got into the business, and you already talked about your first hit recording, which was Kissin' Time. And then you had a lot of great, hits. You had Kissin' Time, Volare, which is an interesting thing that you did back in 1958. You did the English version of Volare.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Actually, that was 1960.
Oh, was it 1960? And, okay.
Yeah, it was 1960 when that record was released, Frank. And that became my second million seller. My first million seller was a song called Wild One.
Right.
And that was like, I think, 59 or 60 as well.
Yeah.
But Volare has become more or less my theme song. And when I'm working on stage, prior to going on stage, the band plays ba-da-da-ba-da-da-da. Right, and then I walk on, I do my show, and then my bow music is Volare as well.
Oh.
You know, so a lot of people associate that song with me, much more so than Domenico Modugno, who wrote and recorded the song, and Dean Martin as well.
Right, and I said 1958, I meant to say that's the first time I heard that song in 1958, that was the Italian version.
Oh yeah, well that was Madrid.
Right, exactly. And and then like you said, you had Wild One, Kissin' Time, and here's another interesting song, Wildwood Days, which later on in Wildwood, New Jersey, you got yourself a street name there.
Yes, I do, and it's right on Skellinger Avenue, and the reason I record, you know, my grandmother, God rest her soul, she came from the old country in a place called Abruzzi in Italia. Mm. And my grandmother had a boarding house. And my mom used to take me there when I was an infant. So I spent 3 months, you know, the summer, you know, June, July, August, down in Wildwood, New Jersey. So that was like my second home. It was like South Philadelphia, but south of South Philadelphia on the Jersey Shore. And the original recording, I think, was done by a group called the Dovells. It was a B-side. And Bernie Lowe, who was the owner of the company that I recorded for a Cameo, he knew that I was a Wildwood guy. And we called in an arranger by the name of Stephen Garrick from New York City, who wrote a different arrangement on Wildwood Days. And it was, you know, it was one hell of an arrangement, you know, with brass and, you know, B3 Hammond organ. And it was just a wonderful record. And if you go to Wildwood, New Jersey, and you walk on the boardwalk, you're going to hear Wildwood Days every 15 minutes. You're going to get sick of it.
Wildwood, it sounds like the description when you listen to the lyrics, Wildwood Days, Wildwood Days. It reminds me of a spring break, laying on the beach 24 hours or something like that.
Oh, yeah. Spring will soon be gone.
Summer's
coming on.
Yeah, exactly.
And I'm dreaming of lots of summer love.
Yeah, you know, that would...
All I think about after school is out heading down the shore, having a ball once more.
Wildwood Days.
Wildwood Days.
And that would be a great, I think, theme song every yearly when the kids go out on the summer break, which is spring break, which is what, around this time right now? You know, that would be.
I guess it's over now. But,
yeah. Yeah.
I know they played the heck out of it in Wildwood, New Jersey.
Growing up in Philadelphia, you had some friends along with you. You grew up with a few friends that you're still stuck with, you know, and we'll talk about that later. You call yourselves the Golden Boys.
Yeah, right. Sometimes when we go into a particular city and the marquee is up and it reads, you know, the Golden Boys, but the G has fallen off, so it looks like the Olden Boys.
That's
my God, I'll be 79 this month, April 26th.
That's right.
Avalon just turned 80, and Fabian just turned 78.
Wow. And you guys grew up together. You're brothers. You're like brothers.
Well, you know what? Frankie, Avalon, and I, we go back. I've known Frankie since I was 10 years old. Frankie mm-hmm. played trumpet, and at that time I was playing drums.
Mm-hmm.
And we've been friends since then. Fabian only lived a half a block away from me, but I never knew him until we both met in the business.
Mm-hmm.
I was on the 2400 block of South 11th, and he was on the 2500 block of South 11th, just a half a block away from where I was born and raised.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, in South Philadelphia, and I would imagine, like in Brooklyn and the Bronx, you know, there's certain areas where you have a certain amount, you know, a certain hang, you know, with the guys or the girls around the neighborhood. And each little section, you know, changes. So I never really had the chance to meet Fabe until we met in the business together.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Well, we're going to talk more about that because I know you guys are still together and you still do shows. So we're going to talk more about that later in the show. Let's go back to 1950. You did this amateur show with the Paul Whiteman group, right?
Correct.
Yeah, you know, how
that was a show called the Paul Whiteman TV Teen Club. And what it was, it showed amateur talent, you know, on the show. And I don't know if you remember, Frank, but Sammy Davis Jr. recorded a record of the old song Because of You. And on one side he did singers doing actors, and on the other side he did actors doing singers to the song of Because of You. And I did on the show the side of actors doing singers, right, and to the tune of Because of You. And I did like Humphrey Bogart, James Cagney, Jerry Lewis singing Because of You, and I won on the show. You know, they had had the meter, you know, the applause.
Yeah.
The audience at the meter, we go from zero all the way up to 10, you know, so on and so forth.
That's right.
And I became a regular on the show, and I was 10 years old at the time, and I lasted on that show until I was 11. The show went off the air, and I was out of work. I couldn't find a job.
Wow. How long did it take you to get back in the groove?
Oh, well, you know, being a drummer, you know, I was always in some kind of a band, you know, and I would play drums and sing. And, you know, back then, we didn't have, you know, what they have today, you know, the phones, the earphones that, you know, just wrap around your mic. Yeah. I used to put, like, a mic stand in front of my drum seat. You know, a regular microphone in front of my drum seat, sing and play around the microphone on drums.
Gee, technology has come a long way. Bobby, we're going to take a break. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to The Blue Cafe. My name is Frank Allan. My guest today is Bobby Rydell. Stay right there where you are because we're coming back for more.
Kissing in Cleveland, Kansas City team. They're wailing in Wildwood, back in Waterloo. They're scooching all over, even in St. Louis. So baby, get ready, I'm kissing you. Oh baby, cause summertime is a kissing time, USA. So treat me right, don't make me fight. The battle of New Orleans tonight. They're kissing on beaches, see the shiny sea. Smooching on benches, neath a kissing tree. Lipstick on collar, down in Tennessee. So baby, come on now, start accusing me. Oh, cause summertime is a kissing time, USA. So press your tasty lips to mine, sweeter than wine and it feels so fine. Kissing and driving you to Baltimore, rocking and dancing, land and sea and shore. Denver to Detroit, they all know the score. So baby, oh baby, what are we waiting for? All for summertime is kissing time, USA.
That was his very first hit. That was Bobby Rydell, Kissin' Time, right here on The Blue Cafe with yours truly, Frank Allan. And Bobby Rydell is my guest today. You are also an actor. All of my years in show business, and I know a lot of people, they're not only singers, like, you know, guys like Sinatra, you know, they're singer actors. Sinatra's just not a singer, he's an actor.
He's a great actor.
And it just seems to me that a lot of people who do sing wind up on the screen. A lot of people. I mean, I can name a lot, but, you know, we're talking about you right now. When you started your acting career, you started... Now, let me see if I can get this right. Was it 1962 when you did your acting career? You started on Comeback, that series Comeback with Vic Morrow. Was that 1962 or 1964?
I believe it was, Frank. I'm not quite sure. I'll tell you a little story about that.
Uh-huh.
The casting director was a man by the name of Lynn Stolmaster. Uh-huh. And I think he's still alive today. And, you know, he casted me in Combat.
Uh-huh.
One of the series of the Combat was called The Duel.
The Duel,
and
that's right.
Vic Morrow, myself, and a German tank. That was it.
Right.
And I was stuck under a truck, you know, for the whole episode. And then Glenn Stallmaster came up to me and he throws me a script. He says, Bobby, I want you to read this and then I want you to read it for me. Okay, so I read, you know, not the whole script, but, you know, maybe two, three, four, five pages. And I read it for Lynn Stallmaster. And he said, Bobby Rydell just gave me one hell of a reading. And Mike Nichols kind of hemmed and hawed, and he said, no, he said, he's not what I'm looking for. The picture was The Graduate, and Dustin Hoffman, of course, got the part. That, you know, but, yeah, so, I mean, at least I you know, I read for it.
Yeah.
But I didn't get it, but I read for it.
Yeah. And by the way, I just watched the duel last night. I just watched it last night. I was on the watching on YouTube. You know, I have to do my homework here.
Yeah, right, exactly.
Yeah, 1962. They say I read your bio, and they say 1962. But if you go on YouTube, the duel that was labeled 1964. So I'm just going to say that you actually did it in 1962 because a year later, that's when Bye Bye Birdie came along.
Right, but yeah, Birdie came out in
1963. Now this is going to be my favorite part of the show because you worked with a young lady that's every man's dream. And I'm referring to Anne Margaret. And
who would have thunk it?
You're right. Do you realize that when that movie came out, I went to the theater to see it, and all the boys in there, I mean, I'm pretty sure all the girls went wild over Bobby Rydell, but the boys were in the back. We saw Anne Margaret, and that was like, we screamed. It was great. What was it like working with her?
Oh, my God, Frank. You know, we screen tested together for George Sidney, who was the director of the movie. And, you know, when you screen test, you know, they just want to see how you come across on camera, you know, how you're going to look on screen, on the big screen. Mm-hmm. And we read a couple of lines, you know, from the script, and we sang. You know, she sang, one boy, one special boy, and I sang, one girl, one special girl.
Yeah.
And Mr. Sidney said, thank you ever so much, we'll be in touch. I go home to Philadelphia. I'm home 2 weeks. My manager at the time, his name was Frankie Day. He calls me up. He says, they want you for the part of Hugo Peabody.
Yeah.
In Bye Bye Birdie.
Yeah.
So I went to see the play. And Hugo Peabody did nothing. He didn't sing. He had no lines. He didn't dance. I said, what the hell kind of a part is this going to be? Make a long story short, Mr. Sidney evidently saw some kind of magic between Anne Margaret and myself. And every day that I would go to the studio, Frank, my script would get bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger to the point where I was involved with the dancing, the dialogue, and the singing.
My favorite, by the way, sequence of that movie was the dance sequence when
the Lots of Living.
Yes, Lots of Living. That was my favorite. I mean, I loved the whole movie, but that was my favorite.
And that took at least, let me see, I think it took 2 weeks to rehearse and at least a week or 2 weeks to shoot. You know, it was a big, big production.
It was.
Big production number.
Yeah.
And we had a choreographer. Her name was Anna White, and she was just absolutely wonderful. And she broke her leg while we were, you know, rehearsing the Bye Bye Birdie dance number.
Yeah.
And she had an assistant, of course, by the name of Tommy Panko. Uh-huh. But Anna White, you know, before she broke her leg, she taught us everything. And even when she broke her leg, even on crutches, she was still up there, you know, doing the moves that we had to do in the Bye Bye Birdie number. It was a great number to do. Great number.
Wow, it was my favorite. And, of course, you worked with the late Jesse Pearson, who played Conrad Birdie.
We became very dear friends.
Did you really?
I'm trying to remember, because it wasn't too long after the movie that he passed away.
Yeah.
I don't remember from what, but it wasn't really that long after the movie that he finally passed away.
I believe, if I'm not mistaken, I just read it the other day, I believe it was cancer.
Was it cancer?
Yeah, it was cancer, yeah. And he died very young. He was only 49 years old.
Yeah.
Jesus. Boy. And you guys became friends. You, Anne Margaret, became friends. Are you still in touch with Anne Margaret today?
Absolutely. I'll call her. She'll call me. You know, just, you know, how you doing, how you feeling.
Mm-hmm.
And it's been a while since we spoke. Matter of fact, the last time we spoke was when her husband, Roger Smith, passed away.
Yeah.
she said, thank you ever so much, mm-hmm. but you remember how sick he was. And I said, I certainly do, and I yeah. remember, you know, he was, you know, a very sick guy. Mm-hmm. And, I just called to, you know, give her my condolences. And she's been a friend, Frank, since 1963.
Mm-hmm. And when you guys got together for the movie.
Yeah, so we've been friends that long.
Here's something else that you did. But it didn't, I don't know if it took off or not. You're going to have to explain this one to me. There was a pilot that I found, which I have in possession in my collection right now. And it was a show. It was meant to be a series called Swinging Together.
Correct.
Back in 1963, I saw the pilot and you played Bobby Day and the Knights. And you did this one. You did this one with James Dunn. Yes.
Who I adored, you know, I remember his first motion picture, A Tree Grows in Brooklyn, and he won an Academy Award for that. And just to be able to stand side by side with a guy like that, James Dunn, was absolutely fantastic. The pilot was done for Desi Lou, but nothing ever happened with it, unfortunately, you know. But, you know, it was, a matter of fact, Stephanie Powers, she was in it. She was in that show, in that pilot that we did.
I must have missed her. What was her character?
She played the daughter of the guy where the band was going to play, you know,
right.
the music, you know.
And she didn't like...
She wasn't a fan of that.
Right. That's the... That, okay, that
yeah,
was...
Yeah, know, and then finally, you know, in the pilot, and I talked to her, and like, you know, what's the matter with you? And why don't you know this, that, the other, whatever, you know. And then, of course, she loved the music. She danced with her father mm-hmm. to our music.
Yeah.
And I haven't seen her since. That was a long time ago.
Wow. Yeah, 1963. You haven't seen her since that time?
Correct. So, she went on to do Heart and Heart.
Yeah.
I haven't seen her.
Now that music, Swinging Together, that's actually a song, and that was the track that you used on that show. But you actually recorded that. I mean, when the movie started, when the show started, it was there. You were singing. You were on the drums, and you know all of the musicians were on the bus.
Right.
And who composed that?
That was written by when I recorded for Cameo. Mm-hmm. Bernie Lowe was the president. Cal mm-hmm. Mann. And Dave Apple did most of the arranging. Mm-hmm. So the arrangement was written by Dave Apple mm-hmm. and lyrics written by Lowe and Mann, mm-hmm. Rydell Lowe and Cal Mann. Mm-hmm. And yeah, that it, like you're right. It was like the opening mm-hmm. Theme of Swinging Together.
Yeah.
And it was a good record.
Yeah.
It really was a good record. Come on, let's go.
And you know. It was a good record, and you recorded with Chubby Checker.
Oh yeah, Chubby and I have been friends. My God,
yeah,
since the early '60s, and we did an album together.
Yeah, I know.
One of the biggest sellers for Cameo, which later became Cameo Parkway.
Yeah,
I mean, matter of fact, I met Paul Schaefer, and Paul Schaefer said to me, Bobby, he said, man, he said, that album you did with Chubby, man, he said, what a great, great album, man. I said, thank you, Paul. He says, there's one tune I really love on that. I said, well, you know, what tune was that? He said, it's called Your Hits and Mine.
Yes.
And basically, what it was I sang Chubby's hits and Chubby sang my hits.
Yep.
And the song was like something like, your hits, I wish I had your hits.
Yep.
We'd have a long, long line.
That's
we
right.
combine your hits and mine. And it was a great piece of material. And lyrics, and you know, were written by Lowe and Mann. And the music was Dave Apple.
I was going to mention that. I said that was one of my favorite songs in that album. You
yeah,
singing his
yeah.
song, he singing your song. That was really great. Was that the only album that you and Chubby did together? Or?
Yeah, that was the only one. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Bobby, we're coming up for another break. You stay right there where you are, and the rest of you stay there as well, because there's more to come. My name is Frank Allen. The name of the show is called The Blue Cafe. My guest today is Bobby Rydell. We'll be right back. And we have returned. We're halfway down the line of the show here on the Blue Cafe. My name is Frank Allen. Thank you so much for joining us. Bobby, here's a song that we were talking about earlier. It's definitely summertime, so let's get with it right here on the Blue Cafe.
Spring will soon be gone.
Holiday.
Summer's coming on.
One of the great ones from Bobby Rydell. That was called Wildwood Days. That brings back a lot of memories. My name is Frank Allen. It's the Blue Cafe. And my guest today is Bobby Rydell. You recently, well, I don't know how recent it was, but didn't you have an album released not too long ago?
Yeah, we did. I'm trying to remember the title. I believe it was Bobby Rydell Today and Tomorrow.
Today and Tomorrow. I think
that.
It was something like that.
And I was very, very proud of the album, but it never really took off. And, you know, it was things that I really, really loved to do. We did tunes like Bewitched, Bothered and Bewildered.
Yeah.
Here's That Rainy Day.
Yeah.
With full orchestra strings, brass, reeds, percussion, so on and so forth.
Yeah.
And I'm very proud of the album, but it really never did anything.
Yeah.
Much of anything.
I like the way you go ahead of me, because I was going to go there, because I know you're famous for all of your stuff in the 60s, which we all loved, and that was the teenage years for me, but as you grow, which a lot of people don't musically, you went to the standards too as well. I mean, you still sing your oldies, but you go to the standards.
Yeah, correct. Well, that relates back to, you know, my dad, you know, with the big band music, you know, the songs of the late 30s, 40s, you know, and so on and forth. And, you know, the songs that they classify them as the American songbook.
Yeah.
And, you know, I was always, you know, when I was young, I always listened to big bands and jazz, and I never really listened to rock and roll that much, because I love big band music and I love jazz. And that's what, you know, prompted me to, you know, later on in my career to be able to do some of the songs from the American Songbook.
Mm-hmm. I mean, did you, even as a kid, did you like that kind of music then? What prompted you to...
Yeah, I mean, when I was downstairs, you know, in South Philadelphia, I was downstairs in the basement, and I had my drum set up, and
mm-hmm.
I had a little, you know, like a 45 record player, and I would play Tex Beneke, Benny Goodman, Count Basie, you know, Duke Ellington.
Well, then what prompted you to do rock and roll?
Well, I guess it was the only way to, you know, get started in the business. I mean, that was it at the time. And I remember I auditioned for Bernie Lowe with another guy. I can't remember his name. And we did a song called Buddies. Buddies, buddies, the best friends in the world, but two friends can't be buddies and love with the same little girl, yada, yada, yada. Mm-hmm. So anyway, Bernie Lowe liked me, and I signed. I signed with Cameo. And I had three records prior to my first hit that did nothing. And I said to myself, wow, man, I said, this is really not for me. I really dug playing drums. You know, mm-hmm. I really, really, that was, you know, was my first love. And then, you know, 1959, I recorded a song called Kissin' Time, and as they say, that's all history. You know, that's how my whole career started.
I'm also told that you were the, I guess, the first teenage idol, the first, as they put it, they said, was the youngest person that ever headlined the Copacabana in New York City.
Yeah, correct. I was 19 years old, and I remember I worked with two gentlemen. One was Lou Spencer, who was a dancer, and he was originally one of the Dunhills, a great dance team that used to open for Danny Thomas and a gentleman by the name of Noel Sherman, who wrote all of the special material. And, you know, prior to the Copa, we'd go into Pittsburgh at the Holiday House. We'd go to Syracuse, New York, a place called the Three Rivers, to fine-tune the act prior to getting to the Copacabana, because, you know, the Copacabana, that was like the nightclub in New York City, possibly the world, to work the Copacabana. Everybody worked there. And I opened, and the next day I got tremendous reviews, and, you know, and Jules Padel, who was the owner of the club, he loved me, and he booked me there. I don't know how many times I worked the Copa after that, quite a few. But you're correct. I was 19 years old, the youngest guy to work there at the Copa.
Well, they say that once you work at the Copacabana, you're in. There's nothing to stop you after that.
Well, you know, like the song, New York, New York, if you can make it there, you make it anywhere.
Yeah.
It's up to you, New York, New York.
Well, we know whose song that is.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. actually, it was written for Liza Minnelli, because she did the show. But, you know, when Sinatra took it over, that was it. I love the story that how you met Sinatra. I heard that story 100 times, and I know you're probably tired of talking about it. But, you know, for the benefit of my audience, I like to hear that meeting that you had.
Absolutely, Frank. I was doing German TV, and my dad and my manager went to the Copa, and mm-hmm. I was going to join them later. Mm-hmm. So I walk in, and I had a raincoat on. It was a rainy night, and one of the waiters, Carmine, I see him, and he says, "Buddy," he said, "would you like to sit with Frank?" Now, my manager's name was Frank. Uh-huh. I said, "Oh, don't worry about it, Carmen. I'll just go down and join him." Uh-huh. And he said, "Bobby, Frank." And I said, "Frank?" He said, "Yeah, he's in the room. He came to see Joey Lewis," which Sinatra made a picture about his life called The Joker Is Wild.
That's right.
And he said, "Would you like to sit with him?" I'm 19 years old. I said, "Oh, my God, no." You know. So I sat with my dad and my manager. After the show, he leaves, and I said to myself, "Oh, God, I blew it. All I wanted to do was shake his hand." Now, because I was listening to Sinatra when I was 10. Mm-hmm. I loved Sinatra when I was 10 years old. I loved the man. Mm-hmm. So we go up to the lounge to say goodnight to Jules Padel, and from the kitchen doors comes Sinatra. And I called him Uncle Julie. I said, "Uncle Julie, all I want to do is shake his hand." Uh-huh. And Julie talked like this, "You want to meet Frank?" So I said, "I'd love to." Now, Sinatra's sitting at a table with Sammy Kahn, Jimmy Van Heusen, two marvelous lyricists, songwriters, Richard Conte, and Joe DiMaggio, and Frank. And Jules Padel walks over, he says, "Frank, I want you to meet the kid." Sinatra stood up with those blue eyes. He put his hand out. He said, "How you doing, Robert?" He called me Robert.
He calls you Robert.
I said, "Fine, Mr. Sinatra. How
course, of course. He called you Robert. There's not a damn thing you can do about it, Robert.
No, you don't say anything.
I mean, but you know, Sinatra, I noticed that he gets familiar with people. You know, let's say, for instance, if your name was, let's say, Ed, like he calls Ed Sullivan Eddie, or Edward, I say. Call him Edward, you know. So,
yeah, well, you know, there's one story. I don't know if you know, there's a disc jockey here in Philadelphia. His name is Sid Mark.
Yes.
Who plays nothing but Sinatra.
French, right. I'm familiar with him.
Yeah, so all of this was, he was campaigning for Hubert Humphrey.
Yeah.
And he was working at the Spectrum in Philadelphia.
Yeah.
And Sid Mark and Mike Douglas, mm-hmm. who had a show out of Philadelphia called the Mike Douglas Show, mm-hmm. Mike Douglas TV Show,
mm-hmm.
right? So I'm having dinner with my first wife, Camille, God rest her soul,
mm-hmm.
and a guy comes up to me and says, "Are you Bobby Rydell?" I said, "Yes." He said, "Mr. Sinatra would like to see you." I said, "Fine, you know." I said, "Can I take my wife?" He said, "Hold on." And he said, "Yeah, okay, you can take your wife." Okay, now we go back to the dressing room, and Dorothy Ullman, who was Sinatra's secretary, Sinatra's back was towards me, and Dorothy said, "Mr. S., where's Bobby Rydell?" He turned around, he gave me a hug, a kiss, I introduced him to my wife,
mm-hmm.
he kissed my wife, and he says to me, "Bobby, how's the crowd?" I said, "Well, there's about 26,000 people out there, Mr. Sinatra. I don't think it's going to be a problem, you know." So in Italian, which I'm Italian,
yeah.
I said, "Stop the bone at the gendarme," which means feel good and live 100 years.
Yeah.
Now I'm sitting in the audience. Sinatra's on stage. He says, "I'd like to introduce someone to you who is a saloon singer such as myself, and he's a hometown favorite. How about a nice round of applause for my dear friend?" And from what Sid Mark told me, I never knew this, Mike Douglas started to stand up from his seat,
mm-hmm.
and Sinatra says, "My dear friend Bobby Rydell."
Oh, that must have been
now,
a kicker.
And I'm sitting about 10 rows back, and he's going, "Where are you, Bobby? Where are you?" And everybody around me is going, "He's here, Frank. He's here. He's right here, Frank." Throw the light on him. The spotlight comes around, hits me. I stand up from stage. He blows a kiss to me. I blow a kiss to him.
Wow.
Now everybody's saying, "Bring him up, Frank. Bring him up. Bring him up, Frank." From that, he goes right into pop, pop, bum, ba da, pop. New York, New York.
Oh, my goodness. Bobby, we are going to take a final break, and we're going to come back for a final segment. And when we come back within that segment, I want to talk about your book. Ladies and gentlemen, it's the Blue Cafe. My name is Frank Allan, and my guest is Bobby Rydell. We'll be right back.
Forget him. Forget him.
Forget him if he doesn't love you. Forget him if he doesn't care.
Don't let him tell you that he wants you, 'cause he can't give you love which isn't there.
Oh, little girl, he's never dreaming of you.
He'll break your heart, you wait and see.
Please come home to me.
That's just one of my favorites by Bobby Rydell. That was called Forget Him. And Bobby is my guest today here on the Blue Cafe. We're into our final segment. And Bobby, you're also an author. I'm not going to close this show until I get into this, because you wrote a book in 2016.
It's Bobby Rydell, Teen Idol
on the Rocks. Right.
A Tale of Second Chances.
Yeah.
And everybody would, you know, like after a show, I'm talking like years earlier, you know, and you would talk around, you know, and everybody would say, Bobby, you have so many great stories. Why don't you write a book? Now I'm like 19, 20 years old. I said, who the hell wants to read a book about a 19-year-old kid, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So later on in my life, I got together with a guy by the name of Allan, who did a documentary on the Standing in the Shadows of Motown.
Mm-hmm.
And we got together back in, like you said, 2016.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess it was about a year, 2 years, just with a tape recorder, a piece of paper, a pencil, and I poured my heart out to him. And I'm very, really proud of the book. It's really a great book. It's an easy read. And it goes from, you know, when I mentioned earlier, when my dad took me to the Earl Theater to see Gene Krupa, mm-hmm. to the nightclubs up until today. And it's a very sincere book, very honest, and I'm very proud of it.
Mm-hmm. You know, the book also entails a lot of things, and I hope you don't mind talking about it. You had some bad times over your years as well.
Yeah, I sure did.
I know you had...
I know where you're leading me to. Back in 2012,
yeah.
I had a double transplant, a liver and a kidney.
Mm-hmm.
Because after my first wife passed away, I unfortunately started drinking heavily.
Yeah.
And, you know, there was nobody to come home to. There was nobody in bed to tell your stories to, laugh with, cry with, joke with. Unfortunately, I became an alcoholic. I started drinking. And I remember there was one doctor at a hospital right outside of Philadelphia called Lankenhaw. And he said to me, this was 2010. He said, Bobby, if you don't stop drinking, you're going to be dead in 2 years. I figured, well, what the hell? If I'm going to be dead in 2 years, I might as well go out swinging. And he was exactly right, because in 2012, I had a double transplant, a new liver and a new kidney. And from that day on, I started realizing that, you know, this is really the real thing here. You know, you better, you know, smarten yourself up. And I did. I did smarten myself up. And that was all because of, when I do my shows, I try to impress upon the people, Frank, how important it is to become an organ donor. And there was a young lady from Reading, Pennsylvania, which is only 50 miles from Philadelphia, and she was like 20 years old. She got hit by a car, immediately pronounced brain dead, which, by the way, is the only way that you can get organs. You have to be pronounced brain dead. And I got a call from, this was Jefferson Hospital, and they said, excuse me, get your ass over here. And the surgeon was a surgeon by the name of Dr. Cataldo Doria. He was Italian, from Italy, studied in Pittsburgh, and then moved to Philadelphia. He was the guy who put in my new liver. And I thought I was, you know, like the number one guy. But there was a little girl, her name Asaya. She was only 5 years old. And we split Julia's liver. Asaya got 25% of Julia's liver. I got the other 75%. And now today, Asaya is, I think, going on to 11 or 12 years old. And she's doing wonderful. And, you know, my God, that was back in 2012. Here it is, 2021. And she's doing fine, and I'm doing fine. So what I tried to impress upon the people, if you're not an organ donor, the next time you apply for your new driver's license, as a favor to me,
mm-hmm.
please become an organ donor, because it truly is the gift of life, and it is.
Do you ever meet the parents of the child?
Yes, I did. I met the mother and I met the grandparents of the child. And you had to wait at least a year to compose a letter. And you couldn't go into specifics, you know, like, you know, I'm Bobby Rydell, and I happen to be a patient who was the recipient of your daughter's liver and kidney. And a year later, I did a show in Wilmington, Delaware, and we invited Julia's mother to the show. And it was a touching, it was a very, very touching moment after the show, meeting her backstage and her and Julia's grandparents as well. So, yes, I did meet the mom.
All of this was due to the drinking? Or was that was...
I had cirrhosis.
Okay.
Of the liver.
Yeah.
And I went into kidney failure as well. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Did you actually finally admit that you were an alcoholic, or did that take some time?
Yes, I did. Oh, yeah, for sure. I mean, it's in the book. It's in the book, and I was. I drank like crazy. I would get up in the morning, and have double vodkas on the rocks. Oh. I'd have like 10, 12 a day. The only thing I never did was drink prior to going on stage. I never drank prior mm-hmm. to going on stage. Mm-hmm. After stage was done, I got cockeyed.
Well, here you are. You're still here. And I am glad that everything is fine now in that area.
Thank you, Frank. I appreciate it.
Now, here we go. I want to talk more about the Golden Boys, because you, Bobby Rydell, Frankie Avalon, and Fabian, you guys still work together now? You got something coming up in the near future, the three of you guys?
Yes, we do. For people who are interested, Frank, you can go to my website, bobbyrydell.com, and you can go under tours, and you'll see, the shows that we're doing. Mm-hmm. And, we started this show in 1985. A guy who used to be my manager, Dick Fox, he had the idea to put three Italian teenage idols together and do a tour. So we all talked to one another. We all knew one another, And I talked to Frank. Frank talked to Fade. Fade talked to me. We all talked together, and we said, sounds like one hell of an idea. So we started the show. Our first appearance was in Detroit, and it was SRO. It was sold out. And we did something like 60 dates, and everywhere we were, it was SRO, it was the standing room only. And it was fantastic, and I turned to Frank, who I called Cheech, because Frank in Italian, we call it Cheech.
Yeah.
And I said, what, Cheech, I said, this is great, but how long is this going to last? A year, 2 years, tops, it's over. That was 1985, it's now 2021, we're booked to 2022 with the show.
Something, it even looks like you look like you guys have fun when you're out on that stage, the three of you together.
Frank has a great line. He'll say to me, he says, look at us three guys. We all grew up hanging on a street corner together in South Philadelphia. Now we're hanging out on stage together. And we do. We have one hell of a lot of fun on stage.
Wow. Like three little kids, like three little boys having in a little playground. That's what it looks like.
We're not up there to really prove anything. We're up there to have a ball and have fun, and we want the audience to relate to that as well. And they do.
Uh-huh. Let me ask you a question. How would you like people to remember you? Let's say, you're in this business right now, and you're not tired, obviously. You sound so energetic. You sound like you still want to go on forever and ever. But let's say there comes a time when you say, I'm going to just, stay home, take it easy. And how would you like your fans to remember you?
I always said one thing, but now I kind of reversed that. I always said that, he was a nice guy. He was really a nice guy, mm-hmm. which I am. I think I'm a nice guy. I can live with myself, and I happen to be a pretty good person. But there was one thing. I was looking at an interview with Dean Martin, and he was asked the same question, and he said, I like to have fun. Mm. And I think that really says it all, because I do what I do. I love doing what I do, and it's fun. And any time it becomes something other than fun, that's when you forget about it. But I'm going to be 79 this month, the 26th of April, and I'm still having fun.
Bobby, thank you so much. It was great having you aboard here.
Once again, Frank, it was totally my pleasure to be with you on the Blue Cafe.
Thank you, Bobby. And thank all of you for joining us here on The Blue Cafe. My guest has been Bobby Rydell. I'm Frank Allan. Thank you so much for listening. And join us next time on The Blue Cafe.
You've been listening to The Blue Cafe with your host, Frank Allan. The producer, Al Dale. And from the research department, Sandy Pierce. The Blue Cafe was produced under Frank Allan Productions. I'm Donna Spanky.